You're listening to Conferences Online Allergy from Children's Mercy Hospitals and Clinics in Kansas City, Missouri. Today is November 7, 2016, and I'm your host, Dr. Jay Portnoy. Our topic today, Immunology, Chapter 2. Our presenter is Dr. Nikita Raje. She's an assistant professor in the Division of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology at Children's Mercy Hospital in Kansas City, Missouri.
Chapter 2?
Yep.
We're getting into more details now. It's pretty long chapter. Okay. So we're going to talk about the cells and tissue of the immune system. So we'll go over each of those cells, and then we're going to talk about the tissues. So cells, these just give like the mean number of cell counts, and we are all aware of these. Just kind of the thing I wanted to point out is, specifically for lymphocytes, they are age-specific, so this is just an average number, but they could be different in neonates, say 2,500 maybe in the lower side compared to adults, so keep that in mind. All right, so the first one, we're going to talk about what are called polymorphonuclear phagocytes or neutrophils. So these come from the bone marrow, from the myeloid monocyte precursors, and these are produced under the cytokine effect of GCSF, or granulocyte colony stimulating factor. So they are 12 to 15 micrometers in diameter with that kind of nucleus. And they have two types of granules in their cytoplasm. One are called specific granules, which do not stain with H&E stain. And these are formed by these kinds of proteins or enzymes called lysozyme, collagenase, elastase, compared to the other type of granules called azuro defensins and catalysidins. For neutrophils, their lifespan is pretty much a few hours to a few days in the blood. And in the, when they reach the tissue to the site of infection or inflammation, they only live for a day or two. Okay. So those were polymorphonuclear. Now we're going to talk about the mononuclear phagocytes, which are our macrophages and monocytes. So these are produced in two different ways. The ones that which we usually talk about are produced from the in the bone marrow, but there are in the fetal life, they are produced in yolk sac and liver. And these pretty much take, kind of reside in specific organs, and they have different names. So microglial cells in brain, Kupffer cells in liver, alveolar macrophages in the lungs, and macrophages in the spleen. So remember, all these macrophages are not produced in the bone marrow. The ones that we usually talk about are the ones that are produced in the bone marrow from the monocytic precursor. So these ones that are produced in the bone marrow are from the myeloid monocytic precursors under the effect of MCSF or monocytic precursor. And these are a little larger than the neutrophils, so 10 to 15 micrometers. And they have this bean-shaped nucleus with finely granular cytoplasm, right? And that cytoplasm and then contains other substances or granules. Those are called, they contain lysosomes, phagocytic vacuoles, and cytoskeletal filaments. And the mononuclear phagocytes are circulating in the blood, and once they migrate into the tissues, they are going to mature into macrophages. So there are different kinds of monocytes. The ones that we talk about, and classical monocytes, are the ones that are inflammatory markers and are recruited to the site of infection or injury. There are also something called non-classical monocytes that are kind of crawling under the endothelial surfaces, which is called petrophils, and they contribute to the tissue repair after injury. And there is something called intermediate subsets in between these two extreme functions that they have. So the big thing here I wanted to point out is now when we talk about these cells, I'm going to talk about the CD markers. CD markers, CD stands for cluster of differentiation, which means that we, I mean, human researchers basically came up with the system to name and identify different kinds of cells or proteins on the in the cell or outside on the surface of the cell. And those markers are pretty much, you know, you use a monoclonal antibody that goes against that one specific marker or surface or cytoplasmic protein, and that's what identifies them. So it's called cluster of differentiation. So the classical monocytes are positive for CD14, so that's the marker for monocytes, but it's negative for CD16 compared to non-classical, which also have CD16 on them, and then the intermediate is somewhere in between.
Do the different numbers of
Yes, so they mean higher, like
more
strongly positive versus
okay.
positive. And they use, like, you know, there are lots of different, we are not going to go into details about, you know, dim versus bright and things like that, but they, somewhere they are, those things are important. But yes, so here, so if you look at the classical, that's CD14 plus versus the non-classical has CD14 plus, which means they are lower on the CD14 expression. All right, so based on those classical and non-classical, the macrophages, so the monocytes, remember, are in the blood, and then once they go out into the tissues, they mature into macrophages, and then they are activated, they have two types of activation, the classical activation and alternative activation. So the classical is in response to cytokines made by T cells, and they are activated to become efficient killers, or phagocytic activity that they are meant for. But the alternative activation is the one that promotes tissue remodeling and repair. And as you can see, those non-classical monocytes help in tissue repair as well. So it's kind of based on the same kind of concept. One clinical aspect of that is we see that kind of macrophage-induced tissue remodeling and repair in, say, hypereosinophilic syndrome. So there you'll see that those cause more of a problem than help. Okay, so the next type of cell is mast cells. These are again produced in bone marrow under the effect of cytokine called stem cell factor or c-Kit ligand. And I know that, I'm not sure, I think we discussed last year that when it's something related to important for bones, I'm going to put it in red. But in general, I like to go over the concepts to understand it better, so it's not just going to be everything. So again, so important for development, stem cell factor or something called c-Kit ligand, and under that effect they are produced in the bone marrow. These mast cells, as you see here, have cytoplasmic membrane-bound granules that are filled with acid proteoglycans. These bind to the basic dyes, and the granules contain substances like histamine and tryptase. They have IgE receptors on their surface, so they bind to the IgE antibodies, and they are present in the tissues, not in the circulation. Compared to basophils, which are in the circulation, not as much in the tissues. But basophils also have granules that bind basic dyes, and they have mediators similar to them. Again, they express IgE receptors and bind to the IgE antibody. The last one is eosinophils from the granulocytes. So these are all the blood cells that have granules in their cytoplasm. So the eosinophils are, again, produced from the myeloid progenitors under the effect of cytokines IL-5, IL-2, GM-CSF. And each of these, I think it's important to remember the cytokines that are important for development. So these have cytoplasmic granules that contain basic proteins which will bind acidic dyes. And they are present in the tissues, in the mucosal linings, in the blood. All right, moving on to dendritic cells. So dendritic cells, again, can come from two sources. The life protein produced from the yolk sac and liver. And these are the ones that kind of take residence in the skin and are called Langerhans cells, compared to the ones that are produced from bone marrow, and they are different types. They come from the monocytic dendritic cell precursor, and that can give rise to something called what are called classical dendritic cells or plasmacytoid dendritic cells. Apart from these two, sometimes the monocyte can give rise to dendritic cells in presence of inflammation. So these are produced, dendritic cells are produced in presence of cytokine called FLC3 ligand. And as you know, dendritic cells get their name from those dendrites or projections that come out of their surface. So the two important types we talk about are the conventional dendritic cells and the plasmacytoid. The conventional dendritic cells are the ones that we know as antigen-presenting cells. So they are present in these tissues, skin, mucosa, organ parenchyma, and then they travel to the lymph nodes and present the antigens that they came across in those places. Compared to the plasmacytoid dendritic cells, which are early responders to the viral infections, and they produce in type 1 interferons. So they are the factories for these interferons that are important in viral infection. So other APCs other than dendritic cells? Anyone?
Activated B cells.
Mm-hmm.
And macrophages.
Okay. So what else? What are the others? So now think of what can present antigens other than the APCs. In the created cell, right, which has class on MHC, can present to the cytotoxic T cells. So the ones that we talk about, APCs, present to the helper T cells, and then the CD8 can be presented. Any of the nucleated cells can present to these. And what else? One more.
No follicular dendritic cells.
The follicular dendritic cells. These present antigens to the T cells. Okay. So now we're going to talk about lymphocytes and spend some time on these cells because, you know, we are trying to focus on these cells a lot. So these are produced in the bone marrow from the lymphoid progenitors. And these cells are present not only in blood but all the lymphoid organs. So 65% of the lymphocytes are present in lymphoid organs, 15% in mucosal-associated lymphoid tissue, 10% in bone marrow, 4% in the skin, and pretty much just 2% of the total lymphocytes in the body are in the blood. So these lymphocytes are clonally distributed, which means each of the clone or group of lymphocytes have antigen receptor that is specific to that clone, and that can TCR or BCR can attach to only the antigen of one specificity. And they are diverse, so there is a lot of diversity in those antigen receptors that are found, the specific antigen receptors are to millions of different kinds of antigens. So the two types are T cells and B cells, as we know. B cells are got that name because in birds they are formed in something called bursa of Fabricius. And in humans, they are found in the bone marrow. That's where they get their B cell name. Compared to the T cells, which are again produced in the bone marrow but mature in the thymus, and that gives them T cells. And so where do the B cells mature? They're produced in the bone marrow. Where do the B cells mature? They mature somewhat in the bone marrow, but do not complete their maturation in there. They complete their maturation in the spleen. Something to remember, and we'll come back to that. So B cells are different types, and we talk a lot about T cells in our Sompirak, but B cells also have their subtypes, which are called follicular B cells, marginal B cells, and B1 B cells. And these are depending on the different kinds of lymphoid tissue where they are found. T cells, as we know, are alpha, beta, and gamma, delta. So alpha, beta are either CD4 or T helper cells, or cytotoxic cells, or CD8 positive cells. And then T regs which are mostly CD4, but there are CD8 positive T eggs as well. So we are getting more acquainted with these cells. We do not know much, but it's changing. So initially we thought all T eggs are CD4 positive. Now we know that that's not true. And then in fact, actually, there are now B regs, which we are coming to know about. So it's always evolving. So the other types of T cells are gamma delta T cells, which are only about 5% of the total T cells in the blood. They are more frequently present in the different tissues. And then there are something called NK T cells. All right, so this table pretty much goes over all these subsets. And the reason I put it in here is, again, going through the CD markers, just knowing what we are looking at. So CD3 positive, CD4 positive, CD8 negative are the helper T cells. CD8 positive, CD4 negative, and CD3 positive are CD8, or the cytotoxic T cells. And then the Tregs, the most frequent that we know about, are the CD3 positive, CD4 positive, CD25 positive, and FOXP3 positive. So all these markers are important. FOXP3 is important for its function. CD25 is a marker of IL-2 receptor, so which is again another marker for Tregs. And then NK T cells have marker for T cell as well as NK cells, which means they have CD3 and also CD56 and CD16, which are the markers for the NK cells. Gamma delta are CD3 positive, but they can be rated along CD4 and CD8. B lymphocytes, for the follicular B cells, they have class 2 MHC on them, CD19 on them. They have Fc receptors, CD23, compared to marginal zone B cells, which mainly their marker is IgM and CD27. All right, so then we look at the development of B cell, of all the lymphocytes. So they come from the common lymphoid precursor in the bone marrow. And then they either turn into B, they have the B lymphocyte lineage or T lymphocyte lineage. The ones for the B lymphocyte are in the bone marrow, and they kind of form immature B lymphocytes. Some part of the maturation occurs in the bone marrow, and they are released into the blood, and then they go into the spleen where they complete their maturation. And those mature, naive B cells, so they are mature, but they're still naive, haven't seen their antigen, that go into the circulation and then recirculate. Compared to the T cell, T lymphocyte lineage, those cells go into the thymus where they undergo different steps of maturation, and then the ones that come out of thymus are the naive T lymphocytes. Sometimes initially they are called thymic immigrants. And those naive T lymphocytes go into the circulation and then enter the recirculation path of the different lymphoid tissues. So this, again, pretty much shows that once those naive T lymphocytes enter the, this is pretty much how they get activated. So let's start here. This is a tissue site where the antigens are produced. Same goes our skin where the infectious agent has entered. That's collected either from that place and across a dendritic cell, comes across a dendritic cell, and the dendritic cell takes that antigen and enters the lymphatic tissue, lymphatic vessel. On the other hand, some antigens or microbes may enter the blood circulation. And either or, they are going to get into the circulation and go to a lymphoid tissue. So from the blood, it's going to enter the spleen, or from the lymphatic, it's going to enter, say, a lymph node. Here, there are naive T and B cells coming from the circulation, and they are going to come across that antigen that's going to be presented to them by the dendritic cell. And here, they are going to get activated if they come across the cognate antigen, which means the antigen that can activate that particular lymphocyte. Once that lymphocyte is activated, it's going to proliferate and expand, which will form a clone of those lymphocytes with that antigen specificity and form what's called effector T lymphocyte or effector B lymphocyte, which is a plasma cell. And then that's going to produce antibodies or cytotoxic T cells or helper T cells, which is going to produce cytokines. And those effector cells will go to the site of infection. If these antigens enter the spleen, it's going to do the same thing. There are going to be effector molecules produced from the spleen, and they're going to go to the site of infection. Questions about that? All right, so that was activation. And here we are now going to talk, so we talked about the different subsets of lymphocytes. Now we're going to talk about the lymphocyte subsets based on antigen exposure. So based on the antigen exposure, either they're naive cells, activated and effector T cells, and then memory lymphocytes, not just T cells. So for the, say for the helper T cells, there's antigen recognition. Once they turn into, they are activated by that antigen, they proliferate, form the effector T cell, and so they differentiate into the effector T cell. So either they turn into a cytotoxic T cell or a helper T cell. This is a helper T cell, so it's going to produce cytokines as its effector function. And instead of the effector cell, the activated T cells may turn into a memory T cell. Compared to a B cell, it's the same process, proliferation and on activation. They differentiate into the effector molecule, which is a plasma cell, and produce antibodies, or they may differentiate into a memory cell. And based on their, I think the table goes to these different subtypes, and based on their surface markers, they can be identified. So the big differences I want you guys to keep in mind is naive cells are small in size, and they have very little cytoplasm, and they are called small lymphocytes compared to the activated or effector cells, where they grow in size and have more cytoplasm, and they are called large lymphocyte or lymphoblasts. Again, the memory cells are smaller in size. And their markers for naive cell have something called CD45RA. It's an isoform of one isoform of the CD45 marker, compared to activated or memory cells, which have CD45RA. Other important markers of naive cells are, apart from CD45RA, are L-selectin or CD62 ligand and the CCR7, which is a chemokine receptor, compared to the activated cells, which are low on these markers. The IL-7 receptor, or CD127, is high on naive cells as well as memory cells, but not on the activated or effector cells. This IL-7 receptor is important for survival, which is important in naive and memory cells, compared to the activated or effector cells. Well, the IL-2 receptor is important and present in high amount compared to the other two. And that's important for function, which is more important in the activated or effector cells. So these markers are important because they help us differentiate these. And then among B cells, there are different kinds of markers again. So naive cells have IgM and IgD compared to activated cells, which have IgG, A, or E. So they are switched cells. Again, memory cells can be already switched, so they will be similar to the activated or effector cells. They have CXCR5 chemokine receptor, which takes them to the B cell region. So those are present on the naive cells. But CXCR5 is low on the activated cells because they no longer need to go to the B cell zones. They need to go to the site of infection. So they are low on that chemokine receptor. The other marker is CD27, which is high in the activated and memory cells and low in the naive cells. Again, the naive cells, B lymphocytes, are also small, with a little bit of cytoplasm compared to the activated ones, which are larger, so they grow in size and have more cytoplasm. Or once they differentiate into a plasma cell, they have a different morphology. We'll talk about it. So to sum it up, the naive lymphocytes are mature, but inexperienced lymphocytes, they haven't come across their antigen. Once If they do not come across their antigen, they will die in 1 to 3 months. They are smaller in size. They are in the G0 stage of cell division, so they are not activated. Once they are activated, they grow in size, and they require, so because they are naive, they have not come across their cognate antigen, they still need survival signals, and those are provided by two things. One, they keep recognizing self antigens weekly that gives them the activation, and then the cytokines help them to keep them activated. So for T cells, that's IL-7. And then for B cell, there's something called B cell activating factor, or BAF. And then when we talked about that marker CD45RA, what it means is the CD45 has a segment that's coded by exon A, and that's called restricted A. So RA stands for restricted A. Compared to the effector or memory cells where that exon spliced out, and so out, RO stands for that restricted A is spliced out. Okay, so the effector lymphocytes, we said they grow in size, proliferate, and then differentiate into the effector cells. They express different kinds of molecules. So if it's a T helper cell, it starts expressing CD40 ligand, which will help them to interact with other cells on activation. Another name for CD40 ligand?
CD40. Yeah.
And then the cytoplasmic, in the cytotoxic T cells, they express the cytoplasmic granules. They also have, they have expression of the activation marker, which is CD25. Now, effector lymphocytes are short-lived, and they do not self-renew. For the B lymphocyte, the effector molecule is the, or the cell is the plasma cell, which has a different morphology. It has an eccentric nucleus. It has chromatin around the nuclear membrane in a cartoon pattern. They have lots of organelles or endoplasmic reticulum and Golgi complex in their cytoplasm. And then they are factories for antibodies, so they produce thousands of antibodies every second. These plasma cells develop in the lymphoid organs or the site of infection, but then they go to the bone marrow, live there, and then secrete antibodies. And there's something called plasma blasts. These are the precursors of long-lived tissue plasma cells. In the blood, they are found in low numbers. So this pretty much tells us, so anyone tell me what type of lymphocyte is this? Which one's the naive and which one's activated?
A naive?
So A is naive because, remember, it has a rim of cytoplasm compared to the C. There's a lot of cytoplasm and larger in size. So just another. And then this one's pretty much, again, showing those organelles here. Okay, memory lymphocytes. So these are kind of quiet over months or years, and their markers are for memory T cells, it's CD127 or IL-7 receptor. So IL-7 receptor has a second name, CD127. And they have something called CD45RO. As I explained, the exon A is spliced out, and that's the reason it's called RO. And then for memory B cells, they have membrane IgG, E or A on the surface, and they have CD27, which is the important marker for memory B cells. That's all for the lymphocytes, so that's quite a bit of information. Any questions? I think the big thing is all those markers you have to keep in mind. I think the most important being the CD45RA and RO, which I would concentrate on as first year, second year, start memorizing everything. So, okay, so the ILCs are innate lymphoid cells. These are, again, bone marrow derived. They have morphology that's similar to lymphocytes, and their effector function is similar to lymphocytes, but they lack the diversity, so they lack the TCR, and then they lack, they are important in early defense, but they are not as varied in their specificity. So they recognize and eliminate stressed and damaged cells, and there are different types of ILCs, and these, each of those type of ILC can produce different kind of cytokines, like the helper cells, or they can be the NK cells. So NK cells are a type of ILC. And then some of them produce lymphoid tissue inducers like lymphotoxin and TNF. Which what it means is lymphotoxin and TNF is important during the development of the lymphoid tissues, the secondary lymphoid tissue, and they produce some of this framework that's needed for the formation of those tissues. So that brings us to the lymphoid tissues. So we are done with the cells. Now we're going to talk about the different tissues. So the generative organs or primary or central lymphoid tissues are bone marrow and thymus. And then the peripheral lymphoid tissue includes lymph nodes, mucosal immune system, spleen, cutaneous immune system, and then there are some lymphoid aggregates in other organs and connective tissue as well. So I think that now most of these slides have a lot of information on them. I would kind of just focus on the major features. We have already gone through some of these things in Stone Para, so we are kind of building on that. So bone marrow, so all of the blood cells are generated in the bone marrow, and that hematopoiesis formation of the blood cells is at birth present in all the bones of the body. By puberty, the hematopoiesis is only in the flat bones, which is like sternum or vertebrae, iliac bones, ribs. So the bone marrow has something called red marrow, which is like a reticular framework in between the bony trabeculum. And in that reticular framework, the spaces in that framework, it contains blood-filled sinusoids. Sinusoids meaning big cavities that are lined by the endothelium, but that endothelium doesn't have a continuous crescent membrane, so makes it easy for the blood cells to go in and out. Outside that framework are clusters of the precursors of the blood cells in various stages of development and mature cells. So once they start maturing, these aggregates of blood cells are going to go into the sinusoidal basement, go through the basement membrane, and then they kind of get into the circulation through the endothelium. So this pretty much just shows the different kinds of cells that we already talked about. The hematopoietic stem cell self-renews and then produces another cell that's the multipotent progenitor. So it's not symmetrical. It doesn't give rise to two similar daughter cells, one self-renewing the other one progenitor. And that progenitor can then get committed to either a lymphoid lineage or myeloid lineage. And that lymphoid lineage forms either pro-B cell or pro-T cell that will form pre-B cell and pre-T cell, and then finally a B cell and T cell, compared to the colony-forming unit mix or BME. So BME forms, M is for megakaryocyte, E is for erythrocyte, and B is for basophil, and then the CFU mix forms the other types of cells, so monocyte or the other granulocytes. And pretty much what the show is showing is as you go from the various stages of maturation and differentiation, the lineage-independent growth factor receptors reduce on their surface, and the lineage-specific growth factor receptors increase on their surface. So markers as well as the receptors change over their differentiation pathway. Again, I think this slide, I'm not going to go into the details. I think the big things that you need to remember are the different cytokines that are important for different cells. So the stem cell factor or the c-kit ligand is important for all the cells. For mast cells, that's the most important cytokine. IL-7 for T lymphocytes. IL-3 and IL-5 for, IL-3 is for all the lymphocytes, all the cells, not lymphocytes, and then GM-CSF is for granulocytes and monocytes macrophage activation, MCSF for monocytes, GCSF for granulocytes, and FLT3 ligand for the dendritic cells. That's it for the bone marrow. Now we're going to talk about the thymus. any questions for the bone marrow? So thymus. Thymus is a bilobed organ in the anterior mediastinum, and each of the lobe has multiple lobules that are divided by septa, and that each lobule has something called cortex and the medulla. So the cortex is on the outer side, and cortex, like in other lymphoid tissues, is a T-cell region compared to the medulla, where the thymus, in the thymus, it's mainly formed by sparse lymphocytes, macrophages, and dendritic cells. And there are some non-lymphoid cells. So there are cortical epithelial cells and medullary thymic epithelial cells. The cortical epithelial cells produce IL-7, so they give the signal for survival of these cells, or the T cells. And then the medullary thymic epithelial cells present self-antigens to the developing T cells. So remember, we are all, everything's focused on the T cell maturation in the thymus. So each of this cortex and medulla is just formed to support that development and maturation. So in the cortex, the chymocytes, or the cells that are destined to be T cells, are entering from the bone marrow, going into the circulation, then entering the thymus in the cortex, and those thymocytes form dense collections compared to medulla, where they're going to go in and have go through the maturation. And for that, you need these different kinds of signals from the cortical epithelial cells and medullary thymic epithelial cells. And there's something called Hassel's corpuscles in the thymus, which means they are just kind of a collection of epithelial cells in the medulla and remnants of degenerating cells. So again, coming back to the same thing, lymphocytes are in various stages of maturation in thymus, and all of them are called thymocytes. In the cortex, the immature thymocytes are present, and they undergo some part of maturation and enter the medulla, where the mature thymocytes are found. And once they complete their maturation, they exit the thymus and are called the mature naive T cells, and initially called recent thymic immigrants. It's pretty much showing the lobule of the thymus with the cortex that has denser picture, that are the collections of T cells, and the medulla, which is sparse, has lymphocytes, macrophages, dendritic cells, and things like that. And those are the Hassel's. Okay, moving on to the lymphatic system. Just shows different lymph nodes and this lymphatic vessels. So where does it start? It starts in the tissues, where through the blood vessels and capillaries, there is interstitial fluid that's released into the tissues that's collected by the lymphatic capillaries. Lymphatic capillaries are formed by just overlapping endothelial cells with one-way valves. So they can enter, but they cannot come out. They do not have a basement membrane or tight intracellular junction like the blood vessels. So once these lymphatic capillaries take the interstitial fluid, it's going to flow through the lymphatics due to the contraction of the perilymphatic smooth muscle cells. These are arranged in series. So lymphatics kind of go forward and go to the different lymph nodes, and then they converge into larger lymphatic vessels and end up in either the thoracic duct or the right lymphatic duct, and end into the superior vena cava. And pretty much per day, there's 2 liters of lymphatic fluid that ends up in blood circulation. All right, moving on to the lymph nodes. These are encapsulated, vascularized secondary lymphoid organs. So they have a capsule on the surface, and the lymph that's brought in comes through what are called efferent lymphatics. The lymph then goes into what is called subcapsular sinus, and then that drains into medullary sinus at the end, and that forms the efferent lymphatics through which the lymphatic fluid comes out of the lymph node. Sorry. So that's the lymph flow through the lymph node. There are different zones in the lymph node called B cell zone and T cell zone. So the B cell zone forms, as we know, something called follicles. So structure that has a specific structure that's called primary follicles, and then over part over time, it can form something called secondary follicle. So the primary follicle does not have germinal center. Once the B cells come across their antigen, they form a germinal center. Once they have that germinal center, they are called secondary follicles. And they have different B cells, proliferating B cells, called centroblasts and centrocytes, depending on whether they are proliferating or not. So that's B cell zone. And then there is something called T cell zone, which is also called paracortex, and it's organized in cords. So again, going through the same information.
Here is
the capsule encompassing the whole lymph node. Under the capsule is a subcapsular sinus, and the antigens enter the lymph enters the efferent lymphatic vessel, goes into this subcapsular sinus, and goes through different lymphatic vessels, and then ends up in something called medullary sinus, and then goes into the efferent lymphatic. The lymphocytes, so naive B and T cells, come through the blood vessels and enter different zones. So there is a paracortex or the B cell zone. So the B cell zone has the follicles, and if it has the germinal center, it's going to be called a secondary lymphoid, a secondary follicle, compared to the paracortex. So in any of these pictures, you see that there are they have these
trabecular
or cord-like structure, and that's the cortex, the T-cell zone. So it's kind of well seen in here, parafollicular cortex, and then those follicles. Here it pretty much shows how those cells enter. The naive B-cells are going to go into the follicles compared to naive T-cells that enter through the high endothelial venule in the blood vessels, and those end up in the cord-like structures of the lymphoid, a lymphoid structure. So I think we went through this. Okay, so for the T cells in the paracortex is a network of something called fibroblastic reticular cells, or FRCs, that form FRC conduits, or tube-like structures. And those FRC conduits contain extracellular matrix molecules like collagen fibers surrounded by a basement membrane. So pretty much these FRC conduits form the framework for that paracortex around which the T cells come in. And they extend from the subcapsular sinus across to the medullary sinus and up to the cortical blood vessels with high endothelial venules. So similar to the B cell zone, which have the FDCs, the T cell zone have FRCs. And those FDCs and FRCs produce chemokines, which attract specific cells. So for the B cells, it's CXCL13, and for T cells, it's CXCL19 and CXCL21. So these are produced by either FRCs or FDCs, and they attract the cells that have a receptor CCR7 or CXCR5 on them. So naive T cells have CCR7 on them. So when they enter the lymph node, they are going to go towards the CCL19 and CCL21, which is present in the T cell zone. Compared to the naive B cells, once they enter the lymph node through the high endothelial venule, it's going to express CXCR5, which is going to go towards the CXCL13 that's produced by FDCs. These are present in the follicles. That's the reason the B cells end up in the follicles. And the third type of cell, called dendritic cells, that enter the lymph node through the lymphatics, attached to the antigens that they are going to present, they also express CCR7, and that's how they end up in the T cell zone, where they can present that antigen to the naive T cell. So again, these receptors and these chemokines are important. So the antigen delivery to lymph node. So basically, once the antigen enters the lymph node, it is sorted by molecular size. So the subcapsular sinus, remember there's a capsule on the lymph node and there is a subcapsular sinus. The floor of that sinus has will only let some molecules pass through it. So there are sinus macrophages that will take up the microbes and high molecular weight antigens, and then the low molecular weight antigens are going to get out of the sinus and through the FRC conduits, and then they are passed on to the resident cortical dendritic cells. So the dendritic cells that are resident in the lymph nodes, not the ones that were coming in through the lymphatic, and they again present the antigens to the T cells. Compared to the sinus macrophages, the ones they take up these microbes and high molecular weight antigens, they'll present these to the B cells, the cortical B cells. Again, I think, again, I wouldn't focus too much on all the details, but remember how they end up, how different antigens end up in different places. And then the last one is spleen. Spleen is a very vascularized organ, and it has two regions, red pulp and white pulp. The red pulp is blood-filled, just vascular sinusoids, compared to the white pulp, which is a lymphocyte-rich region. So talking about the red pulp, the blood enters the spleen through a splenic artery, and that splenic artery divides into different branches and ends up into what are called vascular sinusoids that are lined by macrophages. Once the blood flows through that, that sinusoid ends in a venule, and that will carry the blood into the splenic vein. So that's the red pulp. Now the white pulp is arranged around something called central arteriole, or artery. So the splenic artery forms these sinusoids, but also gives rise to branches called central arteries. And along that central artery is the white pulp with the T cell region and B cell region. So the T cell region is called periarteriolar lymphoid sheath because it's around the central artery, it's called periarteriolar. And then the B cell zone, which is called the marginal zone. So let's look at that. So this is just the white pulp. Say here is the red pulp, here is the white pulp. In here, there is a central arteriole, and around that is the T cell region or the periarteriolar lymphoid sheath or PALS that has T cells. And then there is something called marginal zone around the marginal sinus. So the central arteriole then forms branches called follicular arteriole, and that ends in a marginal sinus. And the cells around that are called marginal zone cells, specifically marginal B cells that we talked about, a subtype of B cells. Apart from there is a B cell zone that has the follicles that we know, that's the basic structure in lymph nodes or spleen for the B cell zone. So again, PALS, B cell zone, and marginal zone are parts of the white pulp in the spleen. And then the regional immune system is found in other mucosa and some non-encapsulated lymphoid structures and connective tissue. Thank you.